I'd like to introduce the next panel. Both of these distinguished presenters are with the Scripps Center at UC San Diego. The first speaker will be Dr. Michael Dettinger, who's a research hydrologist with the U.S. Geological Survey, as well as being at Scripps. He has his PhD from a small college up the street, UCLA, in atmospheric sciences. He's a distinguished scientist. He's monitored and researched water resources in the mid of the West for over 25 years, focusing on the very important issues of regional surface water and groundwater resources. Impressively, he has been a team leader for the Department of Interior, Department of Defense Ecosystem Planning in the Mojave Desert. Many other elements of his distinguished career are available in the detailed program that you picked up. He will be followed by his colleague, Dr. Daniel Kahan, who's also at Scripps, who's also with the U.S. Geological Survey. And his work has focused on many items related to our general subject, but specifically on climate variability and changes over the Pacific Ocean and North America. I welcome first Dr. Dettinger. Thank you.
So far today, we've talked about ice, about glaciers, ice, ice. Now we're going to switch over to seasonal snow, at least for the next couple talks. And in particular, most of my work has been in the western U.S., western North America, and you'll definitely pick up on that as I go forward, although I will show a couple of at least northern hemisphere maps to provide some context along the way. What I'm going to do is a little bit twofold. If you're not familiar with what's been going on with our seasonal snowpacks and the like in the West, you'll hopefully pick that up from what I'm talking about. And I'm talking really here about the historical record. Dan will be talking more about projections into the future. And if you are familiar a bit with what's been going on with our snowpacks in the West, well, don't zone out. What I'll also be doing is providing updates to what is getting to be a little bit older literature now. The colored histogram here is annual global mean temperatures from about 1890 to just before 2000. And we've seen this in various forms already today. The blue curve, both the jagged one and the sort of broken line version, shows the corresponding annual mean temperatures over the area of the western U.S. Highlighted in white here on the map. Okay, and you know basically what we've seen over the course of the 20th century has been a warming. Shouldn't be a surprise to anyone here. When you zoom into the western U.S., you're not doing so much averaging of space around space, and so the curves get a lot more jagged. But if you look at the central tendency, both of the trends, both of the global and of the regional temperature here, you can see that these are both plotted on the same y-axis. You know, we're looking at a warming in the western U.S. that's really quite comparable, this long-term warming, to the global pattern. Doesn't have to be that way. There are most places in the world aren't that way. But as it happens, we're sort of at middle latitudes, halfway between the tropics and the polar region. We're largely sort of trapped between the middle of the continent and the ocean. And we get this moderated version that isn't, as it happens, so far from the global pattern of temperature rise. So, you know, in the style of this talk, let's bring it up to date. And now this I've brought up to 2010. And you see that the temperature has continued to rise, or at least it's stayed up there. There hasn't been a reversal, and both in the regional setting and in the global setting. And why I say it hasn't reversed itself is, first off, we have to consider why, in particular, the Western U.S. has warmed. You know, is that all global warming? Is some of that natural? What's going on here? And so, you know, on the global warming side, this is essentially a first-order estimate of how much extra heat has been trapped in the global atmosphere over the course of the 20th century. This is IPCC fourth assessment period estimate of that. And what's going on here is both the heat trapped by the greenhouse gases, anthropogenic greenhouse gases, but also essentially subtracting off that the moderating effect of sulfate aerosols, which is to say the haze from societal pollution, air pollution and the like, which reflects some of the heat, the light back. And when you take both of those into account, you get this curve. And so there's been a gradual rise in that net heat being trapped in the atmosphere since about the time, at least since the time of the Industrial Revolution. Some people would argue since the time of the Agricultural Revolution. But really, you know, there's a order of magnitude. This slope here is 8 times as steep as that slope. Another contributor is natural variability. There are a number of processes in the global climatic system that really have time scales that are multi-decadal. They'll take 30 years to work their way through in terms of a wandering up and down of global temperatures, or at least regional temperatures and the like. And the one that typically is most important for us in the Western North America, or the one that's most obvious for us, is what's called the Pacific Decadal Oscillation. This is a variation of the atmosphere and ocean, especially focused, by the way we've defined it, in the northern Pacific. And these colors here, the blues are cooler than normal conditions, and the yellow are warmer than normal sea surface temperature conditions. This pattern is reflected by positive values up here in this index of that oscillation. The blues would flip the signs on everything in that map over here. And over here on the continents, we're looking at the temperature response, the air surface air temperature response to this PDO. So when it's in a positive phase, all these dots are red, and that's warmer conditions. The blues are cool in that condition. When it reverses, the opposite's true. Upshot of this is if you look at the last 50 years, the PDO has gone from a period starting in about late 1940s, where it was mostly in the blue phase, in the negative phase, which would make us cooler than normal over here. And after 1976, 77, we flipped into a phase that was dominated by the positive phase of the PDO, which has us all red dots, all warm. Okay? And it doesn't take much to imagine that if I start doing trend analyses on this time series, which if you look into the past, it isn't a straight trend. In the 1940s, it was in the positive phase. Fitting a line to that, you're going to see a trend. So this long, slow variation of the North Pacific climate is sort of ideally situated to make it difficult for us to know whether these warming trends in at least Western North America are natural from the North Pacific climate or are some sort of response to that anthropogenic greenhouse forcing that I showed you a moment ago. So again, let's push forward because that curve ended in about 1998 also. And, you know, here's what we've seen since then. And I can tell you that when we were sort of sorting out what this PDO meant and did and trying to figure out what it really meant in terms of climate change and the like, we spent a lot of time in this period, the climate folks, we spent a lot of time saying, you know, what we really need is for, you know, is for the PDO to reverse itself again. And then we'll know, you know, if the trend breaks, if all this warming we see in Western North America disappears, you know, oops, maybe more of it was PDO than human anthropogenic. And so essentially the late spring of 98, by God, the thing flipped, you know, just on schedule for us, for those of us who are about my age. I've still got a good 15 or so years to play with this thing before I retire, that kind of thing. It could have waited until out here, and then I would have never known the answer, I suppose. But so, you know, so it's really important to us the post-98 period is an important period to look at for us in North America to understand how much of this stuff is natural and how much of it is that warming that I showed you is greenhouse gas. And so, you know, my objective here, as I say, was to show you what's been going on with snowmelt and the like around the West, but also to give you an update of the literature. And in part, that's because a lot of our identification of the trends were published right about in here, somewhere in the very late 90s or into the early 2000s. And so it's important to have a look. Did the story we were telling then hold up? And I'll give you a clue, yeah, it did. What happened there? Okay, so let's move on. Okay, so this is from an article that Dan and I and others published in 2001. It's springtime temperature trends over North America. And, you know, you can see it cut, you know, we published it then. It cut out in about 97. What timing? Reds here are, again, warmer than normal conditions. Or it's a trend towards warmer. You know, that's sort of the picture we had going into about 98. So what happens since then? Here are some versions of the pattern of warming since 98. So here's our springs map. You'll remember that the previous slide, it was, you know, very warm up in Western Canada and drooping down into the Western lower 48. What we've been seeing in springs since 98 is still very warm in the Southwest, a bit, you know, some cooling actually showing up in the Northwest, Pacific Northwest. Here, that's springs. Here's annual temperatures, by the way, since 98. You can see it's all in the warm colors now. They're all in the same color bar, I should say. And actually, here's this year, just so far this year for grins. You know, lest you be worried that this is some refutation of these trends, here's a northern hemisphere look at the same stuff. This is for the period since 1950, essentially, and you can see that, you know, with that longer time period, which was mostly reflected in the earlier publication, you know, we still see, you know, this is showing up. So on the long haul, adding 10 years didn't really change that pattern so much. If we look at this more recent period here, this period, you'll see there's a bit of a gap in the warming here. And what's really kind of going on is that we went from mostly a period of PDO with cool in the center of the North Pacific and warm around the west coast of North America on the ocean to now more recently, since about 99, that phase, the opposite phase, which is warm in the middle of the North Pacific and relatively cool. I don't think the color is coming through particularly well here, but coolish along the west coast. And that oceanographic situation, that sea surface temperature situation is such that for us, up in the Pacific Northwest, we're seeing a lot of that influence. You know, that's kind of been what's largely, I think, stalling those trends that we saw earlier in the last half of the 20th century in the Pacific Northwest. I would note, though, that if you look around, all the way around the northern hemisphere, you know, that's a blip, that's a natural variation in what is a broad continuation of the warming that we've been seeing in the last half of the 20th century. Now, I should say, kind of returning to the Western U.S., one of the things that a group of us at Scripps, working in concert with folks from Lawrence Livermore National Lab, did a couple of years ago was to take a couple of these ocean atmosphere GCMs and climate models and run them for close to 1,000 years with no change in the greenhouse forcing. So we let the climate sort of evolve and oscillate around, and these were control runs that allowed us to characterize the natural variability of climate over long periods of time in these models. And then we went in and looked at them to see how often you saw trends of the sort, in this case, Bonfi led an effort that, you know, where we looked at winter daily minimum temperature trends. We looked at the historical record. We looked at a simulation of the climate forced by historical greenhouse gas changes. And then we looked at these long control runs and asked, you know, how often did we see trends of the sort that we've seen in the historical record and in the historically accurate simulation in the natural variability? Take a 50-year chunk. This could be natural variability, but how often did you see them? And this histogram here, this bell curvy looking histogram here, is, you know, this is what you get in the in these long control runs in terms of the amount of trend that you would typically see spread out over the Western U.S. That guy there is the observations. Okay, so this would put us way out on the tails of natural variability to see a trend, to happen upon a trend of the sort that we've seen in observations and in historical simulations recently. I should note, this wasn't pulled out entirely at random. Winter and spring minimum temperatures have everything to do with when and how much snowmelt you arrange for. And so this is a very snowmelt-centric sort of measure of temperature that she was looking at. But so we did this formal detection attribution study and found that there was a strong tendency to believe, strong basis for believing that what the temperature trends we'd seen of this particular flavor have been associated with greenhouse gases at a high level. Not entirely explained by, but strongly associated with. And I'll tell you what that means in a bit. But so moving on, that was all temperatures. Where's the snow? Okay. Well, in order to get to the snow, let's talk about the, first of all, you know, what we've been doing over the years is looking at various contributors and measures of the seasonal snowpacks across the West. Here's a study that Noah Knowles led a few years back, where we looked at weather stations across the West. And one of the things that weather observers do each day is tell you record how much snow they saw fall that day, how much new snow. Well, we don't necessarily believe that number, but we do believe that they know whether it snowed or rained on that given day, whether there was any snow. And so what we did was go in and look at the precipitation records and ask, how much of the snow fell on days with snow, I'm sorry, how much of the precipitation fell on days with snow versus without snow. And what we found was that although on the whole there aren't large regional scale trends in the amount of precipitation, all these red dots are places where there are trends toward, the red circles are places where there are statistically significant trends over that period there in the rate, in the percentage of precipitation that fell. The red ones are where there was less snowfall, more rainfall. Okay, so this is a conversion from snow falling across the west to rain falling across the west. About three quarters of the sites we looked at were showing that tendency towards more snow, less rain across the west. This went up through 2004. A little bit of bringing up to date, you know, adding a few more years doesn't change the story much. And yeah, both of these are just trend maps for different chunks. So nothing suddenly reversed after 2004 in that study. Our postdoc, Tapish Das, recently published an article in which we looked to see the looked at changes in the number of days that were snowy versus rainy. This is in the same context as that detection attribution with the long control runs of GCM and that sort of stuff. So this is, you know, a sort of model-aided attempt to attribute whether those changes were associated with natural variability or whether they were forced by the greenhouse, increase in greenhouse gases. So again, statistically significant across most of the West that is snow-dominated historically, these trends are going on. Phil Mote up at the University of Washington a while back now did an analysis of all the red, again, same color scheme, all the red dots are places where there have been strong trends towards reductions in the amount of snow sitting on the ground on April 1st across the West. The April 1st snowpack water contents at several hundred places across the West. These records are made by people going out at the first of each month and sticking a tube into the ground to measure how much snow is on the ground and weighing the that and all that. Here we go, adding the additional years. The dots are smaller now, but that's because I never could figure out how he was, how he determined what ratio, what radius to plot. Not surprising, we also, in that same Scripps Livermore study, went through and did an attribution, a formal attribution of these this period changes in the snow water equivalent as a fraction of total precipitation changes to and it, we're able to attribute it confident with high statistical confidence to greenhouse gas increases. Pushing on a little bit more, now we're into the more of the indicated rather than the indicator stage. When the snow melts, it becomes, a large part of it becomes stream flow, and when that stream flow shows up in rivers across the West is a pretty good measure of when, you know, when the snow is melting. And what we have seen across the West is a tendency, same color scheme, a tendency for earlier snow melt stream flow to show up. I haven't been telling you how much some of these trends were. Here it's easier to do than some of the others that were in standard deviations and the like. This one, you know, these are the size here is on the basis of date. And if you just take and lump all the dots I've got here, blue, white, red, whatever, throw them all in together, what you find is that the average across Western North America there in the area shown is roughly, during that period there, was roughly somewhere between 9 and 12 days earlier over the course of that period. 9 to 12, depending on whether you decide to keep in only the statistically significant trends, whether you want to, you know, whatever games you might want to play with it. You want to stick to the U.S. and not use the British Columbia numbers, that sort of thing. So talking about something, you know, creeping up on 2 weeks earlier. This is the hydrograph, the the amount of the amount of stream flow in a river here, basically in the Sierra Nevada, draining down to into Sacramento. The red is the 90s, the blue is the 50s. Just take the whole decade, average day by day what the flow was and plot it up. And yeah, what's happening is we're moving runoff from this period, April through July, which is really key to water managers for reasons I don't have time to go into right now, but moving that water into there. The total amount of runoff under these two curves is within a couple percent of equal to each other. So picking these two decades meant that I didn't have to worry about one was wetter decade than the other. They're about the same amount of wetness, but you know, you're getting water pushed into the winter, which is dangerous water because that's when our big storms come in California and in the West, a lot of the West. And so that's when that water is viewed as a flood risk as opposed to something that we like to have around for irrigation and the like during the summer. Bringing that up to date, basically you're still seeing pink dots most everywhere. Trends, this is just taking that same diagram, adding a few more years to it. No surprise that it doesn't change a whole lot. And then here is just comparing the 2000s to the last 30 years of the 20th century. And so, we didn't suddenly see a reversal back to the kinds of streamflow timing that we saw, say, in the 1950s and 60s when the PDO was in the other phase. Now here's springtime. Springtime temperatures across the northern hemisphere. And I've chosen this odd period here because that's a period when I have enough data in enough of these international streamflow stations to actually calculate some meaningful trends in the timing of streamflow in places outside the US. And basically, you know, what we see is all these black dots are places where there's a statistically significant, in this one, they're all statistically significant trends towards earlier runoff, earlier snowmelt runoff in almost all of these cases, earlier runoff in any case. And it's interesting, you know, we have our big whack up here where that big blob of warming was going on over Western Canada. There's another big blob of warming here, associated pretty well with that one. Not so much seeing it down here in eastern, more or less eastern Siberia. But in any event, so the trends that I've been talking about in the Western U.S. really are part of a more global pattern. And to put a little perspective, it's nice in some of these things to actually be able to look back at the record and say, well, you know, what about extreme events? And these two, what I'm looking at here is the number of stream gauges that are, you know, really, you know, way at the far end. They're in the earliest quintile of their whole historical record. So each year I just go through all the stream gauges and ask how many were, in terms of their timing, in the earliest quintile of their whole historical record. And when you do that year by year by year, there's a lot of variability and the like. I just want to note here that 2004 and 2007 stick out as the two two record breakers in terms of this earliest stream flow across the West. And so that's kind of in keeping with a broad general trend is when you start seeing record buildings. It's sort of like when people tell you that you know, 8 of the 10 warmest years globally have been since about 1990. This is our local equivalent of something like that. And I should say 2004, 2007, both of those are since the PDO shifted. No surprise, Hugo Hidalgo, one of our postdocs and then researchers at Scripps now at the University of Costa Rica, was part of the team and led the effort to do the formal attribution of stream flow timing in this complex of control runs and GCMs and all that. We had to downscale things and bring them through hydrologic models in order to pull this one off. But again, this trend, this is actually the weakest attribution, but again, statistically significant attribution that this is not, this is highly unlikely to be purely natural variability. Okay. And then finally, what the team as a whole, we were doing these various indices of change, but part of the scheme here was we wanted to be among the first to do a formal detection attribution for a region, for a hydrologically relevant variables, and for multivariate, for a combination of variables. So, you know, each of those different individual detection attributions were all feeding towards the effort that showed up in Science in 2008, where we looked at the combination of all three of these guys. And, you know, so we felt that we would get greater statistical strength by having this combination of attributions all feeding into it. And what we found here, finally, I break the news. You know, we found these high levels, you know, you're thinking 95, 99% confidence levels, so, you know, high levels of attribution, of statistical confidence. But we were also able to basically say two additional things that are worth noting. One is that we figured that roughly 60% of the trends that you see in most everything I've shown you so far were caused by greenhouse gas, rising greenhouse gas concentrations in the atmosphere. So roughly 60%. It leaves 40% for other stuff. We couldn't say what, you know, the assumption was largely natural, but it could be other human influences and local influences and the like. But we were able to attribute about 60%, we believe, of the trends across the western U.S. at least have been associated with rising greenhouse gas levels. The other thing that's worth noting is that we also look to see when you should first be able to detect these trends in a meaningful, you know, in this sort of attributable sense. And that was really sort of by the late 80s into 90s, it was there. You know, the signal is there. It's risen out of the natural variability. You should be able to detect it. So that's this was sort of the capstone on that overall study. There have been other detection attribution studies. I'll just note, you know, Cynthia Rosenzweig from NASA GIS published a study in Nature where she looked at flora and faunal distribution changes. And, you know, similar sort of arguments, similar sort of methods, and attributed some statistically significant amount of that kind of change to greenhouse gas origins, which I think brings me to my final slide, which is, okay, so I'm going to summarize with this slide. And you know, what we've seen is that there have been large changes, significant changes, in the snow melt, the seasonal snowpack and snow melt regimes across the West that we have done our level best to attribute through formal means, formal tests, to the greenhouse gas warming across the West. The change from positive PDO to negative PDO in roughly, well, pretty close to late spring 98, I mean, you can almost look at the maps to see the date, did not break the back of those trends. So that there has been at least something else going on besides the Pacific Decadal Oscillation, which for a long time was our public enemy number one in terms of being sure what was going on. But that didn't break the back of these trends at all, didn't reverse them to any extent, really. And then the reason for having this up here is I should say that the asterisks are associated with all these different observations that we've now gone through this formal detection attribution process to really show that, you know, on the basis of our best statistical analysis and using the models in as intelligent a way as we can. We didn't, you know, treat them as, oh, models are perfect. We tried to treat all the uncertainties fairly and that sort of thing. These are all among the trends we've observed, and now we've done a detection attribution to attribute them statistically at a statistically confident level to increasing greenhouse gases. But the other point here, and I'll wrap up with that, is just to note that, you know, what I've got up here is, you know, all the various observed. I've also got, you know, I've got your basic precip gauge here, you know, a guy with a snow tube over here, a hydrologist wading across a stream, measuring the stream flow there, and on and on. We actually did work, I didn't show it here because I can't update it at this point in time, but we looked at the timing of first bud, first flowering, essentially, in the lilacs that were distributed all across the West, and found similar trends and that sort of thing. These are all, and I should note, you know, throw in the temperatures, which are measured with a thermometer someplace historically, and birds and the like, which, you know, that's your Audubon Christmas bird watch sort of thing. So that's citizen science by and large. Different agencies, entirely independent measurements. Nobody is making, well, with the exception of thermometers and stream and precip gauges, these aren't being made by the same people, you know, individuals. Often different places, all that. You know, they're all telling the same story. And so, you know, what we've got is a situation where there's a very good and coherent and I think a relatively complete story of change associated with change in seasonal snowpacks across the West in the late 20th century, now into the early 21st century, that our best model and statistical work suggest are attributable to greenhouse gas warming. So that's the story.